Well, everyone, thanks for your patience. We've still got a queue that's wrapped around the building, so we're still trying to get students into the other two lecture rooms. So thanks for waiting for what's going to be a fantastic opportunity for us to hear an intimate conversation with Jean Nouvel and Andrew Mackenzie and Daryl LeGrew. My name is Alan Pert. I'm director of the Melbourne School of Design here at the University of Melbourne. I'd like to begin proceedings by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which this event is taking place, the land of the Wurundjeri, and pay respect to their elders, both past and present. As I say, the school is delighted to be able to host Jean Nouvel tonight in his first visit to Melbourne, and hopefully one of many to come. Jean Nouvel's work is widely recognised as some of the most innovative and inspiring work within the design world. The Institut du Monde Arabe, the Foundation Cartier, both in Paris, the Densu Tower in Tokyo, Lucerne's Cultural and Congress Centre, and the Abgar Tower in Barcelona. The Quai Branly Museum at the foot of the Eiffel Tower, the Tour de Verre in the heart of Manhattan, and the soon-to-be-complete Louvre, which is scheduled for completion at the end of 2016, are all but some of Jean Nouvel's notable projects. Now, this is a career that started in practice in 1970, includes co-founding the Mars Group in 1976, and then he went on to establish the first Paris Architecture Biennale. Jean has over 80 awards to his name, including the Pritzker Prize in 2008, architecture's highest honour. And by 5:30 p.m. today, I had a quick look, and Jean had over 4 million mentions on Google. So he's certainly popular within the architectural community and the design world. Now, after winning the Pritzker Prize, a French newspaper ran a congratulatory piece titled "The Architect Who Refuses to Behave." Maybe we should have said "The Architect Who Doesn't Like to Conform," which was a conversation prior to the lecture tonight. Now, to introduce my other guest tonight, we've got Andrew Mackenzie, whom most of you should know, who previously edited the Architectural Review in Australia, an inside interior design review, and now runs Uru Media, a multi-award-winning publisher of architectural and design books, the most recent including The Mongrel Rapture. We also have Professor Daryl LeGrew, who's the Dean of the Architecture, Building and Planning and Vice-Chancellor's Fellow here at Melbourne University. Daryl himself is an internationally recognised researcher and practitioner, and Professor LeGrew works extensively within the fields of university futures, campus futures, urban architecture and creative thinking. Now, as you've probably gathered, it's not going to be the traditional lecture. This will be a conversation. Andrew will be our chair tonight and our compere. We will be looking for audience engagement, so Andrew will be seeking questions, I'm sure, throughout the night. There is a slideshow. We've got 46 minutes of slides. We were planned to finish at 8 o'clock, but the conversation might go on, so get comfortable. I'd also like to introduce and welcome Mr. Nouvel's translator, Nicola Savage, who joins us on the panel. So, please join me in welcoming Jean, Daryl and Andrew.
It is a tremendous honour to be here this evening and to have an opportunity to talk to you. I thought maybe we could begin at the beginning, maybe, and think back to the time when you finished at the Beaux-Arts and you first started working. I believe you worked for some time with Claude Parent and Paul Virilio, was that right?
First, at all, I have to explain to you that it will be a very difficult end of the afternoon, because my English is a broken English, a disaster. I wanted to have a simultaneous translation, but it's a consecutive translation, so I decided to talk like this. Very often it will be a lot of English faults. I apologize, but I think it's better like this, and I have help. If I don't know a lot of words, I will have a translation immediately. I did not wait to finish my school to work. That is a tradition in France also very often. I work in different places, but I work mainly in the Claude Parent and Paul Virilio office. My license, that was 4 or 5 years later. Mm-hmm. So for five years, I had, the best school. Mm-hmm. Because that was around 68. Mm-hmm. That was really the mess in the school. In 68, arrived a lot of new professors, very good in revolution, but less in architecture. And Claude Parent and Paul Virilio. Claude Parent, perhaps you don't know him. He's very well known internationally, mm-hmm. and in architectural school, you know. But with Paul Virilio, he has a real interest in the military architecture, the mm-hmm. bunker archaeology. Mm-hmm. And they invented theory in architecture on the oblique occupation of space, mm-hmm. Fonction oblique. And Paul Virilio became the famous philosopher that we know now. Mm-hmm. I work with Claude Parent himself. And during the afternoon, when Claude Parent was in other places, Paul Virilio, he likes to talk. Mm-hmm. And that was private school for 3 or 4 people. Mm-hmm. And I think that was the best school. So after, when I in the school, I had my license. I decided to open my office immediately because Claude Parent helped me. Mm-hmm. And gave to me little works he had to do in supermarkets, little architecture, very little. But that was enough to begin. And very quickly also, I could begin the architect of the Biennale de Paris. That was the exhibition every 2 years, like the name said that, of all the artists in the world, artists below 35 years. Mm-hmm. And that was a way to meet them. That was very important, and also a way to do the museography or the scenography of their work in the main institution in France, in Pompidou, in the Musée d'Art Moderne, and so on. Mm-hmm. That was my beginning.
And what's interesting is that obviously that practice was composed of an architect and a philosopher.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And in fact, I believe there was also a painter and a sculptor in the early days. And that therefore, in your own practice, you have over the years embraced multiple disciplines and the arts into the core of the practice. I understand you've had conversations with Jean Baudrillard and others, that the work is almost as much founded in a philosophical inquiry as it is in the practice of space.
Yes, it's not a permanent situation, but it's an attitude in relationship with what is this this work to be architect. And I think really, I thought really at this epoch that the Beaux-Arts was a very strange school, and probably a lot of schools all around the world. Very old-fashioned, and we learned recipes exactly like a chef in the cuisine. And you have to repeat always the same things, and if you want to obtain the values, every month or 2 months we have a bon point, I don't know the name in English, a good point. We have to follow exactly what the professor said. That was, for this reason, perhaps that was a long time after, but not so long time, 6 or 7 years after I began, I wrote a text, an architectural text in France, to say the future of architecture, architecture with a big A, is not architectural. To explain that it's not that they, all in all the school you had this idea of the architect like an autonomous discipline, but you need also to integrate so many notions, cultural approaches linked to philosophy, to art, to aesthetic, to cinema, to everything, and we have, of course, to integrate the life. So that was not at all the system of the teaching. I think always approximately the same thing today. I think, of course, like a musician, you have to learn the notes and to do solfège and to have the minimum, the bagage to work easily. But it's not automatically with, I say that in a school with many disciplines, but I think probably for architects, poetry, philosophy, images, voyage, trips, journeys, visits are probably more important in the order, of course, than constructive systems, calculation of a beam. We have mathematicals quite high level, not so useful. It's interesting at the beginning to have a shape of the spirit, but after it's not so important. And what we can see today is an evolution of this work, very sad, because the real work of architecture, of an architect today, is probably to have a vision of the future of the life of many people in different places. And it's more a way of poetry, it's more a way of humanism than a way of a rational approach. And the first gesture and the first approach of architecture is the essential act of architecture. And now, in the development of the main cities in the world, and mainly the megapolis and the metropolis and all the suburbs and all of that, all the decision, evolution of the city, all the decisions are taken by technocrats or politicians, by engineers of infrastructure, with the idea that the rational question, with this vision, with this narrow vision, is the most important first point. And we have also the same academical vision of the way of urban planning with summary cartography, with densities, very often with regulation of the height, very primary notions. And we arrive in a world where the cities are done, fabricated in this way. I think now architects, real architects, are far of that now because they lost the power. I don't know what is the situation in Australia, but they lost totally the power. And the initial decision, the most important decision for the future of the inhabitants, are taken before the arrival of the real act of architecture.
I think we have a very similar situation
yes.
here, in the sense that the power of the architect that, I suppose, we were both born in 1945, within a month of one another, and by the time the 68 revolutions came in Europe, there was also a revolution here. We were revolting against the Vietnam War. We were trying to claim architecture as a discipline central to the way in which the environment might project itself into the future. And in many respects, the passion of those days, I don't find it here. And I mean, I'm only here as a dean for a very short time, but if one of the things I can get going again is that feeling that one way or another, the architect as the poet, the interpreter of society, the cultural doyen should use that authority and that power to, as you say, Jean, have the vision for the future, and a future that is much more exciting than the one that the technocrats have planned for us.
It's not to say that the architect has to do that alone. I think the pluridisciplinarity is very important, of course, but the original vision is really the most important things today. And in the same evolution, why we lost totally the power? Because 20 or 30 years ago in Europe, an architect who has the responsibility of the construction, really, of the prices, now it's finished. And for every people in the street, the responsible is always the architect. But now the contractors, the big contractors in France, has the power, and has the power also to, in the choice of the architect with a new system of development of competitions. We have to follow the order of the contractors. And generally, they cancel what is too complex. They don't follow exactly the market. Contract. I think it's not the same word, I apologize. But this evolution is very sad. And I think it's not possible to do architecture if you don't have, it's like a conductor in an orchestra. If you want this note, you don't want the other one. If you want this instrument, you cannot cancel the instrument. So we are in a kind of bouillie. What is the name?
Mess.
Okay. It's a mess. It's exactly that. I didn't know that meaning of mess that was we. But it's exactly that. We are in something generally not precise, and precision in architecture is essential.
Mm-hmm.
We cannot build something respectable if it's not correctly built, not correctly executed, and not correctly designed and thinked before. To do architecture, c'est prévoir, to see before. Prévoir, prévision.
Plan, or forecast, predict.
Forecast, ça. Mm-hmm. To forecast.
Could we, before we get too depressed right now?
No, we're not depressed.
Could we spill back?
No.
Could we?
It's not a reason to be sad. It's a reason to talk,
fight.
To fight, to talk to the politicians, and to not admit for the future generations, not only of architects. I am not a corporatist. I like this job, but I am not a corporatist. I don't want to defend this work against the other one. Mm-hmm. I want to defend the architecture because it's a social responsibility, societal responsibility, very, very important.
Mm-hmm.
And the societal responsibility has to be assumed today, and now it's not.
It's almost impossible to think back when the Institut du Monde Arabe was commissioned. You were in your mid-30s, almost a similar time. We had Piano and Rogers in their early 30s. working on the Pompidou. What were the conditions that allowed this moment to happen of, frankly, risk-taking at the highest levels of city-making?
I don't know which kind of risk. At this epoch, I was in the same time an architect and a militant. We created with other French, young French architects, the movement Mars 76, because we denounced the fact that every city in France in the urban planning was done by state exactly on the same scheme, with everyone zoning, all the little houses together, all the offices together, all the retail together, industrial, and so on. And the same scheme all around the city, even if it's small city or large city, that was exactly the same. And we wanted to have this responsibility closer of the mayor. After 6 or 7 years after, when Mitterrand arrived, they did that. But it's a lot of dangers after, because when you are too close of the population, the mayor has no authority because he don't dare to take a courageous decision. But it's so it's always a very, very difficult system.
Yeah.
But in the same time, so that was important to do architecture in a very alive way, for me, architecture is a testimony of an instant of culture, always, always, always. So if you forget, I try to be a contextual architect. Contextual is not to copy what is before, what exists before. Contextual is to integrate all the parameters of the situation. And the first parameter of the contextuality is the epoch. You cannot do the same building at 10 years of difference, never, never. Mm-hmm. Because you have other information, you have all of the, and you have evolution of the culture, and you have a porosity between architecture and culture, of course.
And that idea of context in your work also seems to have a very direct correspondence to what is around it, either the topography, the landscape, other buildings. It's something like the Cartier Foundation, perhaps. The old cedar tree, you know, itself becomes a moment around which the building starts to form, which is an extraordinary thing to take a tree and to design a building in direct kind of correspondence to this moment of nature.
I'm Chateaubriand. But I am the son of a professor of geography, historian geography, and I think architecture is totally linked to both. And we forgot very, very often that. With the Mouvement Moderne, we forgot the history at the moment. We thought that the memory was not so important, and this dear Corbu cancelled one part of Paris in one plan like this, Le Plan Voisin. It demolished. He wanted to demolish. Very important neighborhoods, and all the cities and all the ideas was without consciousness of the territory. That was just theoretical. But I think now it's worse, worse and worse. I apologize to have bad news today. But when you look at the world today, the main part of the main buildings are parachuted, dropped like this. And they are prefabricated by computer. And you know that now we can change some parameters, and you can redo the main program of today, housing, offices, shopping centers, and that. All the plans exist. In one day or 2 days, you change all the parameters, you have one project is done. For this reason, perhaps the fees dropped. But But the work of architecture is not this, is not that. Every site, every owner, every people wanted to build has a right to a real study and invention on his site.
Mm-hmm.
It's a question of respect of this job and of these people, and the respect also of the city, because the city is our berceau. How do you say that?
Cradle.
Okay. and if the city is degraded, it is, if we lost the soul of the territory,
mm-hmm.
It's very, very important for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's very important to have a consciousness of the nature of, mm-hmm. of what is our job, what mm-hmm. is to be an architect.
Mm-hmm.
It's not to repeat, it's not to clone. Now we cloned a lot of buildings. All the world is cloned. And when you turn around the world like I do, mm. I promise to you that generally on a picture of a neighborhood of housing, for example, you don't know, absolutely you cannot know where you are.
Mm-hmm.
And you repeat the same curtain walls, the same system, the same constructive system. And generally also, I think that the money put in architecture, in this program, is not on the site, because a good part of the money is linked to subcontracting, and is linked to capitalistic approach of the largest companies. And on the site, the last subcontractor built, generally, he does bankrupt at the end. He's here for that. It's not correctly done.
Mm.
And on the site, you have perhaps 1/3, 40% of the money, really, when you look at the price. 60% are not in the site. I don't know where, but not in the site.
Mm. And we're really bound into the rhetoric of globalization, and globalization then tends to mean homogenization, where everything is uniform and homogenous. One model is translated from one place to another, when, as you say, we should be celebrating the difference. Yeah. We should be celebrating the difference of a place. So the architecture of a city like Melbourne, which has been transformed socially over the past 5 decades, magnificently socially, still resembles the architecture of other places. And I ask why. Why are we not very highly distinctive, highly differentiated, and not globalized? I mean, you can be global in the sense that you're part of a global community, but you actually have something to offer that's different, something that's unique. Yeah,
but
to the place.
But all the system is not homogeneous. I think that Australia is not in the worst situation at all. We talked a little bit about this question a few minutes ago, but...
I'm glad to hear optimist. You're an optimist,
but,
yes.
But I think really all the cities in a huge development, always this philosophy of the emergency, architecture of emergency. And even in Paris, now, they want to put one layer more of emergency. I don't know why, but we have to build 170,000 apartments in the Grand Paris very quickly by the main contractors on the first site free, and with program also. Program are very important, evolution of the programs. Now, a social three rooms apartment is smaller than in the 60s or 70s,
mm-hmm.
60 square meters.
Mm.
And so all of these parameters are political parameters, but it's a responsibility also of the architect. Architect cannot say, I don't see that. It's not my problem, it's a problem of other people. No, we have a responsibility linked to the job, to our societal wall.
We just had some images a moment ago of the Paris Philharmonie, which is an interesting story in itself, and perhaps
that is exactly in the middle of this kind of problem, mm-hmm. because they announce a price, half of 40% of the real price, approximately, officially. They say we have this price to build that. That was impossible. Every people knew that. After, that is a public building, also. So we paid with 100% of public money. Mm-hmm. In France, we have a special law to protect public money and to check public money. They decided to build this project with a private company, private maîtrise d'ouvrage, a private client, like a subcontractor once more. Mm-hmm. And they eliminate the obligation to check the price by the architect. So they put me on the side, and the huge contractor, Bouygues, very well known, the largest in France, work, and the price arrived very, very high level. The price is not, the real price is not on the site also, but you know that not only in France, in a lot of countries all around the world, the big works are also here very often to pay political party. So probably
this is being recorded, right?
Probably.
There's an infrastructure budget coming up as well.
Probably we have a situation, but the building itself is not correctly done. So I do a trial, of course. That was a big fight.
Yes, you went to court.
It's not the project. It's not stupid.
It's a fantastic project,
but,
by the way.
But it's built abominable. Is the English
abominable? Yes.
Abominable.
Abominable way. they put the facade now with every curve. They put I don't know. It's froissé.
Crinkled.
Yeah, crinkled. Yeah, yeah.
And you have, can I invite the audience to go out and
bad place? It's for an architect, it's awful. You have to take some pictures for your school to show what you don't have to build.
Yeah.
Very important.
The issue of El Croqui of the recent work. It's the first time I've seen this with the images of this amazing project, but at the back end. Two or four pages of defects, of non-compliance, and it's the shittiest details you've seen. So it's extraordinary that you take the risk.
It's like a symphony, once more, correctly written, but without conductor.
Yeah.
And with bad musicians. So
after, but it's amazing.
Some you can hear something. In architecture, you have a structure more visible, perhaps, than in a musical symphony. Yeah. But so I defend, of course, the architecture I propose, and I want to defend it until the end. And I want to arrive to a correction, because the money is here for all the French people. It's a national program. Mm-hmm. If you don't put the money here, you rob the money of the French people and of the Meloman also, of all the people. It's in another place. Mm-hmm. So I want to see this money come back.
Mm-hmm. Well, we are also seeing...
I fight for that.
But we are also seeing public-private partnerships of this kind as well, and look, sometimes they work, but nine times out of ten, I think value management comes under it. Everything is value managed because the no one is really honest about.
Like this, and value management is
that's right,
this.
Like that.
Can we pull back a little bit?
I'm not getting depressed again, by the way.
Exactly, to talk about the
architecture. We're talking architecture now.
Yeah, I know.
Say we don't talk architecture. The main problem of architecture today is this kind of problems. And for your students, they have to know that.
Yeah.
They have to fight to not have this kind of situation in that country.
At the same time, with that project, one of the extraordinary things looking at the diversity of the work, one of the big... qualities that changes so much is this idea of interiority and exteriority. And how some projects like Mercer Street, the apartment building, the translucency of that, the use of glass in some of the projects like the Cartier Foundation, it's such a theater of interaction between the inside and out. And then what's extraordinary with some of the performing art spaces like the Philharmonie or the Copenhagen Concert Hall is the incredible closure. And I'm interested in the way you move between those two conditions, which seem, in some respects, so different. What drives those differences?
I think outside, inside is another of the major problem of architecture today. I apologize to talk about the problem, but you push me in this direction. But Schellenkraut system is a stupidity, American stupidity. Very often you design a box. I have this problem in New York City now with the Tower of the MoMA and so on. Mm-hmm. They put to me a French designer inside. He designed generally, he refurbished generally the hotels of the 19th century, like the Ritz in Paris. Mm-hmm. And when you look at that, it's exactly like a very bourgeois hotel all around the world. But I designed a project. I said this project has to be in New York City because the structure was on the perimeter, because the site was so small. And I play with the structure, of course, with the beams, with the columns, and I said he will be like a carpenter living in this structure. And for that, I can sell the secondary or third structure with large glasses. Mm-hmm. So when you are inside, of course, you frame New York City, and after you have large blinds, and everything was done correctly, I suppose. But they decided, because it's a very risky building, because the price, because they cut the head they cut 60 meters at the top, and so of course the value at the top is the largest value, so after that was automatically complex. They did that, and the reason of that is the marketing.
Right.
Marketing people said, we cannot take all the risk. It's very beautiful outside, but it's modern, it's risky. Inside, we will be conformist.
Wow.
But when I cannot imagine one guy who like my architecture and in the same time like the Despont architecture. And the Despont guys, when they see my building outside, they say it's awful. So because it's a question of culture and references. So outside, inside is architecture. Mm-hmm. It does not exist an outside architecture and interior architecture is architecture. Sometimes you need to have a specialization for interior architecture, because all the evolution, the transformation, the mutation of the city are very important. Mm-hmm. And to work in existing building and to transform, that is a real act of architecture, same importance as to create a building since the beginning. For this reason, we need that, but not at the beginning. At the beginning, an architecture is outside, inside. In the Philharmonie, the theme of the Philharmonie is an allegory of music, always. So is it l'envol, what do you say, flight? No, the flight is a vol.
Takeoff.
The takeoff, yeah, absolutely. All the notes of music take off. They go in the space. Mm. And all these curves, you have the flight of birds on the facade, you have all these themes are allegories of music. Mm-hmm. And generally, when you work on big program like this, they are symbolic of the architecture of the epoch, and generally they are monumental references, so you have to take care of what you do. For this reason, it has to be done correctly also, because it's not here for 10 years, it's here for more. And in every case, when you do a building like this, you have to consider the experience from outside and inside, and the penetration of Judith, and all the movement. Mm-hmm. And in the Philharmonies, I did this building in homage to Claude Parent, because it's a lot of slops.
I thought it was.
You can go on the roof. When you're on the roof, you are close of the ring in Paris, so you can see the Grand Paris and the small Paris.
Yeah.
But now they want to cancel the access to the roof. So we cannot imagine what is,
was this
what
maybe
is the life
somehow
of an architect today.
Was there an echo of the Church of Saint Bernadette, the Claude Parent building? When I saw the cover of that building together, I thought, is
Saint Bernadette is another thing. So it's Saint Bernadette is a bunker vocabulary, but linked to the architecture sacré. Mm-hmm. So you have the ray of light, you have internal spaces maximized, you have very, very useful, very beautiful.
But yeah, it becomes a matter of integrity, I think. I mean, if I could give you an accolade for a moment, you don't get a Pritzker Prize, which is rather like the Nobel laureate in other disciplines. You don't get a Pritzker Prize unless you have that sense of integrity. It's rather like Einstein talking about the Nobel, said, look, unless a concept has coherence and integrity and consistency and is at the same time beautiful, then it's not worthy of a Nobel laureate. And that's one of the reasons why your buildings and your body of work is worth the Pritzker Prize, because it does have that level of integrity across the body of your work, which is amazing.
Thank you.
Pleasure. But it's true. It's true.
The thing,
I wouldn't say it if it wasn't true. It is.
The thing I was observing, I guess, is the precision of the penetration of the building in the church with light was so carefully chosen, and that in so many of your works, the framing of a view, as in the city hall, or the placement of a window, what you see, there's something about the visual and how you capture the visual in the building. The building's a frame that's quite special.
Mm. I mean, to do an architecture is like to do a movie, and you have to imagine the movie. And you have to imagine the materiality. And one of the main questions of the epoch is the materiality. For this reason, I work very early on the transparency. Not the transparency for the transparency, because total transparency, obscenity, is not really interesting. Mm. What is interesting is the question of the matter. Architects have to put the question of the matter on the table now. Because the mystery of the life and of the future and of the humanity is in the matter. When you are in a situation with a building, we have the choice now to be transparent, translucid, punctuated, opaque, rough, and so on. Mm-hmm. In relationship with what is around. Mm-hmm. Contextuality is that. It's not to copy the building here since one century before. It's not neo-regionalism. It's the opposite. Mm-hmm. Contextuality is you have to catch and to use what is around you and to give also additional value to this building staying with you. So framing is a very important weapon for an architect, mm-hmm. because when you have a landscape around you, very often it's not so interesting to see all the landscape because you don't have the consciousness very often, and because also you have some parts interesting and some awful things. And so I designed a building like this in New York City, 111th, mm-hmm. and on one side is a total view on Hudson, and on the other side is a lot of little frames on all the buildings of Midtown. When you are in the apartment, you have 15 windows on one side, mm. and on the other side, you have the vision of the rest. But also, the question of what is important is the vagueness also, is every building is here to create a mystery. Art is always linked to mystery. So we have to organize the positive mystery. So for this reason, we play with transparency, but with a rain on the glass, you support a superposition with a second glass, and you don't understand what you see, and the trees above. And like in the Cartier Foundation, three plans parallel, and you have the superposition of the reflect and the reality, the reflection of the trees on the trees, the reflection of the clouds on the clouds, and people do not understand generally why. Something is strange, is fascinating, but they don't know why. So we have to play with all of that. And an architect, for this reason, an architect has to be awake. Awake on the evolution of the epoch. Awake in front of the contemporary art, for example. Contemporary artists are very often explorators of different sensations. You can reuse these sensations in architecture in another scale. You can re-put the situation, this invention in a situation. Artists are very often jealous because architects stay, one power state to the architect is to work at the large scale. But we have to introduce now artists not to go directly to the museum, but in the city at every scale also. Land art, urban art, street art, all of this kind of art has to be in the city, and has to be interferent.
I think the last sentence in your Louisiana manifesto is to discover an unknown color, It does seem to me that
from and time sanity and the dream is knowledge.
Exactly.
Paul Valéry.
Exactly. And I mean, what intrigues me about the design process is one can gather all the information and think of the allegories and analogies and so on. When it comes to the point, there's a blankness that needs filling. And it's the creative urge to actually take the step into the unknown that seems to me to be at the center of your work, and it's at the center of the work of many, many architects who I think can genuinely claim to be great. The question that I would have is, how do we, as educators, move that into the spirit of a school? You mentioned the École de Beaux-Arts in the 60s as being maybe a mess, because we were all a mess in the revolutionary 68, 69, through that period. But you could argue that we're in a different kind of mess now. It's a much more orderly mess. But how do we break out of that? How do we move students to the point where it's not that they forget their knowledge, but they, in a way, they need to. They need to take the next step, in which there is no knowledge, there is only an unknown color.
They have to consider that this job is a huge responsibility. And it's not to design the facade of a cube that you know all the dimensions. And you have not the money to do another technique than the traditional technique you have. In this case, they did study for nothing. We have no responsibility in this case. So they have to fight to obtain the responsibility to give more pleasure to the inhabitants. They are here like a chef in the cuisine, to give pleasure to the people around the table. That is a good job.
Excellent.
Could I ask, since we have the slide up here, it's relatively rare today for architects to issue manifestos. Very often they're
the old text. I wrote that in 2006 or 2007, something like this. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
10 years ago, 9 years
ago. But the role of the manifesto is an interesting one, and more often than not these days, it's a statement of preference than a manifesto. But this is definitely a declaration.
It's old, but actuality is okay.
Yeah, yeah.
This text is right today. 10 years after,
it's still
always right.
It's still right.
Still right.
What was the catalyst to writing a manifesto? What was the moment?
Exactly what I said tonight. This consciousness that something is wrong and architecture is not respected. Mm-hmm. And it's not important for architecture. It's important for the people who live automatically in the architectures. Mm-hmm. So we have to reprecise what is the nature of architecture. Mm-hmm. And architecture is not to do competitions, to be sure that in the corner the angle will be designed correctly, and to check if you have no mistake in the calculation of the ventilation and all of that. It's stupid now. Competitions are suspicion. No, we need
competitions
we need,
are
we
suspicion.
We need poets. Architects. They have to read. They have to visit exhibitions. They have to travel to have a license. It's necessary to have probably, in my opinion, compte rendu.
A report
on 100 cities in the world. Before, that exists in the past. That was the trip to Rome or to
the grand tour. The grand tour.
But here we need that more and more because you have so many different cities in different states, awful, correct, fantastic. And you have an experience every time. In the past, that was classical, and you cannot learn so many things. Now it's very important to see the nature of the world. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And we here sit in the Eastern Hemisphere, so we have the advantage of Asian cities.
We have a lot of space.
We have a lot of space, but we also sit on an axis between Melbourne, perhaps even Hobart and Tokyo, for example, yeah. And the cities in that band from the subcontinent across to the Pacific, north south are fantastically different, and it would be an absolute tragedy if. The 50% of students who are here with us at the moment, who are international students, the majority of whom are from one or other of the Asian states, from China or the Southeast Asian states or whatever, it would be an absolute tragedy if our education was simply a way of transplanting our values into the Asian scene,
yeah,
and
but,
so on.
But what is important in this situation now? A lot of matter arrive in the cities. It's the most important fact, geographical, historical fact of the last century, the déménagement du territoire. But now we have all this matter arriving in emergency, always emergency, without a real thinking about that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And now the mutation, the role of the architects of this century now is to encourage the mutation and not to keep the situation too long time. Because now all the cities are like this, but they are frozen in the same time because other regulation on the property, on different things like this. So you stay with obsolete buildings, very bad. Mm. So now it's important to stop totally the zoning, to transform offices in shopping shopping in apartment and you do that already. I saw that a little bit on the transformation. Australia is not so bad. Huh? I saw that, but we have to push that in a lot of like a tool to create more complexity and to work with this matter. Now with sustainability, we have good reasons to do that, to isolate the building, to create additional spaces, greenness, yes, gardens, and so on. You have a good reason to push the mutation. We have to accelerate the mutation. Transformation, mutation, transformation, mutation.
We are probably going to go to some questions, I think, for a few minutes before, because we're getting close to a close. So if anyone's got a question to ask, it might be the only chance in your life to ask it of John Nouvel. So we have a mic, and so we can take it to somewhere in the audience if we have a question. Do we? Are all you all stunned?
I'm sure there's one there somewhere.
Surely there's a student with an impetuous question.
It's not more difficult to ask a question to me than to another people.
Is there up there? I think there is a... Yes, there is.
The best people are in the back.
I was asked to choose people at the front, but I'm afraid the first one is at the very back.
Test 1, 2. Thanks, great presentation. Merci. I'm wondering, who's your favourite architect and why?
Friend of the company excluded.
Guys, you're going to have to do better.
It's not so difficult for me to answer. Because I answered already to this question. When I had a special issue of architecture d'aujourd'hui 30 years ago, I explained that with my desire to have one different architecture in different ports. And not the same architecture in different port. Mm. And that was a machist comparison with a woman. And I said,
"You're an old Navy man."
And les marins, c'est ça. And but also the character of this architecture. I talk about Barbara Streisand like a character woman. Yes. And so on. So I cannot prefer one city in the world, because I love cities. Mm. I love the diversity. I love a lot of contemporary architects. I love a lot of architecture in the past. I have lover of all of that. So I am a Don Juan of this kind of thing. So I don't want to have a preferred architect. I am not my preferred architect.
This is possibly a dangerous thing. We have another question. Just over. There and then.
Hello. You said earlier that architects are losing their power. And I was just wondering, how do you suggest that architects reassert their power, and how do you personally fight to reassert that power?
Short of a revolution.
It's not a revolution, but it's a little bit that. The action we prepare in France now is not, it's quite secret, but you are far. But we will try to have a kind of manifesto, I don't know what is the name, or article to denounce this situation, but not signed by architects only. We cannot defend alone what I say, because we are not reliable. There will be people saying, you want job. It's not that. So we have to defend that with all the intellectuals, all the actors of the constructions, all the association of inhabitants. That is very important to do that like this, and not to be in a very narrow situation. And at the end, we have to do that in France, in other countries, internationally. I think it's possible. We have the links for that. And we have to create a GNO. I think GNO could be the right tool to talk with politicians, to talk with states, with mayors.
A journal.
GNO. GNO. Organization, ONG.
Oh,
okay.
Oh.
NGO.
Everyone be very mysterious.
We must get a Juno.
I am jet lag.
Okay.
You're
doing very an NGO. Well.
NGO, of course. NGO could be the good tool to discuss after with a responsible politician responsible of territories and cities. It's a long road, probably, but we can try internationally to follow this road. It's not a revolution, it's a quiet revolution, but it could be an evolution, and it could be a strong dialogue. And out of this danger of the defense of the profession, what is too narrow territory and too suspicious territory.
It really does come back to the matter of risk again. Yeah. I mean, how much risk you as students, those of you who are students, and I know there are a lot of you here tonight, how much risk are you prepared to take? I say the same thing to practitioners. Are there ways in which working with your colleagues across the transnational disciplines,
if I might, though, I think the risk is more on the recipient so often, that there are plenty of people who want to take risks, but the context is not exactly receptive.
Oh, sure, but I mean, we're all too risk averse, and we all assume that one way or another, taking a risk and stepping out there and saying the things that we need to say is going to somehow be to our disbenefit, when actually it's not. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are a lot of people who want to hear what architects have to say, but the voice is silent.
Yeah, to be an architect is to have a passion. If you don't have a passion, you cannot do this work, do they? Or you will be a slave, if this is the case. So you have to know that. Consider that you are also an artist. Architecture is an art. And follow your life.
Passion and patience, as you said, some of the projects can take 10, 12, 15 years to mature. We have another question. We've got two questions left, and I think we'll wrap it up. So, yes.
my question gets to the value of design. It's relatively easy to communicate the value of design to people that understand design. But it seems to me you've achieved such great success that you must have a particular skill in justifying the value of design to people that don't necessarily understand design. And I'm just interested if you can share with us some of the secrets you've learned over the years.
In three minutes.
All benefit from that.
I have one secret, absolutely. I can give that to you tonight. If you want to be loved and to create something appreciate, you cannot do the opposite of what the people want in front. I don't say that you have to ask him and to follow exactly what he says. It doesn't work also. But you have to try to adapt, to understand them. And you have to try to propose something acceptable for them. And if you are in the great tradition of architecture, modern architecture mainly, of the artist and the repetition of your vocabulary. You have a special vocabulary. You do only circle, or you do only bricks, and you do only triangle, or you do only... You can never arrive to this target. You need to use a lot of vocabularies. People say very often, Nouvel, he has no style. It's wrong. Because a style is a permanence of an intellectual attitude. That is a style. And for a director of movies, they don't follow exactly the same style. It's wrong. You look at Kubrick, for example, or this kind of guy. You cannot know that it's Kubrick when you look at a movie. But I explain that the most important question is not the starification of the architect. is the starification of the buildings. Every building has to be the star. And every building has to be, has to need to have a kind of idiosyncrasy and total adaptation to a situation, the missing piece of a puzzle. It's a will to find the right building in the right place at the right moment with the right people. When you arrive to resolve this equation, generally, you can go on.
One more question at the back, your hand up there. Yes, no more.
Hi. I as emerging architects, I think a lot of us, we struggle between trying to sell an idea and also trying to feed ourselves. And I'm sure there was a point in your career that you must have faced similar struggles. What advice would you give to emerging architects who struggle with that? Or maybe perhaps you could share what were the strategies you employed when you were emerging yourself before everyone knew the name Jean Nouvel. Yeah, thank you.
How do you feed yourself and follow your dream?
I try to understand the question because it's a permanent defi, this job. So defi, that's
challenge.
The name?
What?
Challenge. Permanent challenge. Permanently. So, and we have to adapt your attitude to the situation, of course. Contextuality is that. So he's never win before. So it's a kind of intelligence of the situation, which we will find the way. Generally straight, it's not true. So you have to take a little pass like this. You have rocks, you go down. You have a little river, you dive, and so on. That is it's something like this. The name is Le Parcours du Combattant.
Physical challenge of doing it.
Le Parcours du Combattant, you understand that?
Physical challenge.
It's a challenge.
Yeah.
It's a challenge. Challenge for the translator.
could I say that in my view, the profession hasn't changed much since the Middle Ages. Whenever the economy went down, there was a local war between princes and so on in the Middle Ages. The architect, the mason and the journeyman and the apprentices, when they went from one cathedral to another, because they could only lay six courses on each cathedral because the mortar squirted out otherwise. When they arrived at Cathedral X or Y and were told by the abbot that, sorry, it's times are tough, I can't do anything these days. And what do you do? Well, the first thing that the mason did was to sack the journeyman. It's pretty well the same now. The contract architects are shown the exit fairly quickly. And the firm holds together until times get a little better. And things haven't changed when you think about the masons being the directors of the firms, the journeymen being the contract architects. The apprentices are not doing too badly now because they're here with us in the academy. I mean, I think, and again, I reflect on a friend of mine, Ole Kortzow, in Copenhagen, who has the thinnest office in the world, I'm sure, but he has four floors, and on each floor there's a different approach to design. There's a different practice, in a way. And if architecture is not going well, then he moves to do a collection for the Royal Copenhagen Ceramic Factory, or he runs an events design studio or a graphic design studio. So there are four things. The important thing is that he never loses the sense of design. The manifesto statement is consistent across all of those four areas, and yet all of those areas touch a different part of the economy, and they all rise and fall at different times. And so being strategic and tactical about the way in which you run your practice is not a bad idea, and having many strings to your bow, all of which are to do with the passion that you have about design.
The real challenge is to like the difficulties.
I think I have a simpler, maybe perhaps, way of summarizing here is that one way to survive is to be a very great architect.
Indeed. That's the best way.
For all the challenges that undoubtedly we face and you face in your practice, I think perhaps the greatest testament to the resilience of architecture and of the architect is the catalogue of projects that you have coming out next year and the year after to look at the work that's happening in the Middle East and in China and in America. We see that actually it is possible to have a position of resistance to demand a certain opportunity and for that to happen. And for you to be able to produce the marvelous work you do. So on that, I would like us all to thank Jean for being with us tonight. Thank you.
Well, that was an incredible hour, and I'm sure you'll all agree it was much better than a standard lecture to get an intimate conversation with Jean. A big thank you to Daryl, a big thank you to Andrew, and also a big thank you to Nicola Savage for interpreting for us. Thank you to all of you. Thank you to all the students in the other two lecture rooms, which are also full. And a thoroughly enjoyable evening, and we'll now wrap up and let Jean go and experience the culinary delights of Melbourne. So please join me once again to thank Jean and the panel.
Thank you very much.